My name is Sarah Hartley. I am the Assistant Dean for Undergraduate Studies and External Relations for the College of Communication and Information Sciences. I know Brooke Bailey because she serves as the president for our College Ambassador Program. She's been with the program for a few years. She's a compassionate leader who loves serving her college. Additionally, I always see kind of what she does on her free time, cooking up meals and trying to teach others how to do the same. She's a great university leader and just a very special person. Please welcome Brooke.
I think I have to turn this on first. Can you hear me? Nope. There we go. Okay, awesome. Hi, everyone. My name is Brooke Bailey, and today I'm going to be telling you about my revolutionary idea, which is that you should take some time out of your week to cook for yourself. So to kick things off, a little bit about myself. I am a senior studying public relations, graphic design, and computer science here at the university, and I'm also from Daphne, Alabama, which is about 4 hours south of here, close to the beaches. I'm a CNIS ambassador, like Dr. Hartley said, so I get to rock the red jacket every now and again. I'm also the assistant creative director for Capstone Agency, and I work at the FERG, so if you've seen me before, that's probably where. My favorite thing ever to cook is pizza. My favorite frozen yogurt flavor is classic tart, and my favorite vegetable-based dessert is carrot cake, which is also my favorite dessert ever, too. So this is a fun picture that I found a couple of weeks ago. That's me with my Nana and my sister, and this kind of illustrates how I've really been cooking for my entire life. I like to say I've been cooking since I ran out of the womb. I really grew up in the kitchen cooking with my mom and both of my grandmothers, and cooking is something that we've been able to bond over in a way that I've been able to show my love for my family. So just a fun way to kind of kick things off. So if this was a recipe that you were using online, this would be that really, really long part before you get to the fun part, the part where you have to like scroll 5 times and it's like someone's diary entry. Well, that's this part, and I'm gonna make you sit through it. You can't scroll through this part. So in the spring of 2017, that was my sophomore year, that was the spring semester, I hit a really rough patch with some mental health issues and was really just having some spiraling problems and was not doing great generally. During that time, I really stopped taking care of myself. I stopped cooking. I'd been cooking forever. I just completely stopped. I stopped eating. My appetite went away. I was really just eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for about 3 weeks. That's all I ate. And so that was not a great time in my life. But one thing that really helped me was finding something to focus my energy on. So I forced myself to get back into the kitchen. I started with simple recipes like grilled cheese, spaghetti, things that I grew up eating and things that I knew I could make without spending a ton of energy, but something that let me take my mind off of whatever was happening, whatever was making me spiral. I really focused on doing that and then forcing myself to eat that food because I'm frugal. I don't like to waste money. So forcing myself to eat really got me from eating just peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. So I've shared my story with you, and that's one of my big tenets. Sharing the journey is part of the journey. So sharing your story with others is a really important part of self-care because letting others know what's going on is really important to your mind, just making sure that other people know and can support you in that journey. So one thing that I started doing right around this time was sharing my journey on social media. So if you follow me on Instagram, you know that I like to share what I'm eating, what I'm cooking, and how I cook that. Part of that is sharing my mental health journey, but part of that is showing other college students that you can cook. That even if you've never cooked before, if you've never stepped one foot into the kitchen to make something, you can do that. And you can make fun dishes too. You don't just have to stick to grilled cheese and spaghetti. So this is something that I like to call the circle of satisfaction. So the circle of satisfaction is a way to kickstart your productivity. If you're having a hard time getting things done, accomplishing tasks, you feel overwhelmed, getting into the kitchen and cooking something is a great way to kickstart your productivity. So the circle of satisfaction basically is you start by picking out your recipe, you go to the grocery store and you buy the ingredients, you prep the ingredients, you chop the onions, you get everything out that you need, you cook the ingredients, and then you, at the end, have this whole meal that you can nourish yourself with. So that's the circle of satisfaction. That's a great way to find a little bit of productivity in your day, which could help you start on a big project that you haven't started on or finish writing that essay that you haven't had a chance to. So cooking is another great way to meditate. So I like to go into the kitchen and turn everything off. and pretend like nothing else is going on in the world. So I'll turn off my notifications. I'll turn on like an album that I'm really into, or sometimes a movie or a TV show that I really like to watch, and just focus on what I'm doing. Focus on the task at hand. And that way you can pretend like you don't have any emails to answer. You don't have any text messages to answer. If your mom calls, who cares? You're cooking. So it's a really great way to turn off the world and pretend like nothing else is going on. So the biggest thing that I hear when I talk about cooking from my friends and from other people is, I can't cook, so I'm not going to. To be frank, I don't care. You can cook. You can get into the kitchen and make yourself cook. There's so many easy recipes that you can start with. You just have to make the effort to start. So I have some action steps for you, and I want you to remember lasagna. Keep this in mind as we go through the next couple of steps. So my first step is that you have to learn to love your grocery store. My friend Erin the other day, when I said, you should cook more, said, I hate grocery shopping. And I said, what? But, because I love grocery shopping so much. It's something that I grew up doing with my mom. She was like a big couponer back in the day. And so like I know the ins and outs of the grocery store. It's like a second home to me. But starting off my week, on a routine, I like to grocery shop on Sunday morning. So starting with that routine is a great way for me to kick off the week and know that I'm gonna have a productive week and that I've kind of got this routine going. So I like to grocery shop, this is really weird, at 8 a.m. on Saturday or on Sunday mornings because nobody is there. If I can get myself out of bed, that is the best time for me to go grocery shopping because I can like walk so slowly through the aisles, literally pick up every single thing, check out the nutrition facts, compare the prices. You're not stressed out when you have that time to do that. So Sunday morning might not work out for you. It probably won't work out for most of you. That's fine. Find a day that does work for you, whether that's a Tuesday night or even a Friday night or a Friday morning or middle of the day during the week when you have some time. But picking a routine is so essential to making sure that you're cooking for yourself every week and that your pantry has food in it. So make a grocery list. This is so, so important. Even if you're so busy, you don't have time to sit down and plan out your meals or do anything, you just have a quick second to run to the grocery store, take a few minutes sitting in your car to write out a couple of things you know you need to get. That way you won't get to the grocery store and be wandering aimlessly through the aisles and probably don't need, and then getting home and saying, I completely forgot to buy like chicken or noodles or something, and then you have to go back to the grocery store, or you don't cook for yourself. The other just quick tip, keep your things organized. This is something that I struggle with personally. Sometimes I will get home and realize that there are 7 cans of black beans in the pantry because I forgot to check or I couldn't see them when I was checking. So keep your things organized just so you know what you have. My next step is a plan is good. So I talked about this a little bit with planning your grocery shopping, but you should also look at your schedule to see when you have time to cook that week. So check out your calendar. For me, I'm usually really busy on Monday and Tuesday nights. So on Sunday, I try to make a big meal that I can eat off of throughout the rest of the week. But that might be different for you. My other tip with this is to be realistic with the amount of time you have to spend cooking. So it's really like when you get started, you're really eager. It's really easy to say, I'm gonna cook 5 times this week, every single night, I'm gonna cook. You're not going to do that. You're going to run out of energy. Nobody has time for that. So pick 1 or 2 days out of the week to cook and make your dedication to that, but be realistic about it. Also, always double check your recipe, because the last thing you want to do is start cooking and then realize that like your chicken is still frozen or you forgot to buy the right kind of rice. Check your recipe before you start cooking. That's just a hot tip. My next is simple is better. So this has been a theme throughout this, but saying simple is so important. I like to say grilled cheese and not duck confit, because first of all, who can cook duck confit in college? And second, you don't want to start too high, fail, and then not want to get back into the kitchen. So if you start with something crazy and then it goes terribly, terribly wrong, you're going to have less energy to get back into the kitchen. Also, call your mom. This is really important to me, is whenever I think of a recipe that I ate when I was little, I always call my mom. But if you're just getting started cooking, figure out what you ate when you were little. Odds are you probably ate it, and you're gonna have an idea of how to make it. So if that's spaghetti or meatloaf or, I don't know, your mom might have cooked something else really weird, who knows. But call your mom or your dad or whoever cooked for you when you were little and get ideas for what you should make. And then find your rotation. So this is a meal that I make probably once a week. This is a frozen veggie burger with whatever frozen vegetable I have in my freezer. It's something quick and easy that I know I'm gonna be able to eat, that I know I can make really quickly, and that's actually pretty good. So find things that work for you, whether that's spaghetti that you can make every week, but adding new recipes in all the time can be really stressful and really taxing and make you not want to be in the kitchen as much. But finding things that you like to make and that you know you can make is really important. Always eat what you make. So you don't necessarily have to eat it if it's burned, but I think it's really important to, even if it looks gross, it might be delicious, but it's so important to actually try your food that you make. So if it's, I don't know, I made a recipe a couple of weeks ago that was like these potato things and it all fell apart and I was like, oh, this is not gonna be good. It was delicious. I don't know why I doubted myself, but it was delicious. But even if things look gross or like they're not edible, you should at least try it. It might not be edible, but you're gonna learn from your mistakes. Learning from your mistakes is a big part of cooking. If you don't make that again to try and make it better, you're never gonna like grow in that aspect. Also, I'm terrible at setting timers. I'm sure several of you can relate. This was some bacon that I burned a couple of weeks ago. I still ate it though because I spent a lot of money on it. So, you know, to each their own, but always, always, always set a timer. Give your food to others. So I talked about sharing your journey, but sharing your food is also really important. We connect over food. Food is a common language. Even if you don't speak the same language as somebody else, you can always connect over food because we all got to eat. So share your food. And this can look a little bit different to depending on who you are to different people. So one of my biggest things is sharing on social media. I almost always post what I'm eating on Instagram or post what I'm cooking on Instagram because I like to share with other people what I'm making and that they can also make that. But this might look like hosting dinner parties for you, bringing your friends together, having everyone cook a different dish. That's a really great way to connect with people and share your love. It might also look like bringing cookies to a meeting. This is something I love to do. I'm a big, notorious stress baker, so I always have random cookies or banana bread or something in my house, and then I'm always like, I don't need this in my house, so I load it off onto my friends. But you never know who can pick me up during the week, so sharing your food like this is really important. Not everything has to be from scratch. Okay, I'm gonna get up like on my soapbox here for a minute. I am not Ina Garten. We are not Ina Garten. Homemade is great, but store-bought is also great. You're in college. Nobody has time to make like bone broth from scratch. I mean, maybe you do. I don't know what you do with your time, but I find that sometimes buying things store-bought is just as great as buying things that are homemade or making things that are homemade. So how I can relate to this, rice is my mortal enemy. I cannot cook rice to save my life. I have on several occasions just eaten a mushy pot of rice because I don't want to throw it out, but it's so, I can't do it. I don't know what it is. It's just like a weird mental block. I can't make rice. So I just buy store-bought rice or store like already made rice. And that's like a little bit of stress that I don't have to have in the kitchen cooking rice. Maybe it doesn't turn out great. And then I can't make whatever recipe. Like if you're making rice for like fried rice or stir fry or something, mushy rice is just not going to work for that. So I just buy pre-made. It's a lot easier for me. Also, frozen food is the bomb when you're in college because it's way less wasteful. It turns out to be cheaper oftentimes. So if you're considering frozen food versus fresh food, I would always say go frozen unless you know for sure you're going to use that entire head of broccoli. Because the worst thing ever is like 2 weeks in, finding like a really moldy head of broccoli in your freezer and then having to like carefully remove it and then throw it out. It's just not fun. So if you looked into our freezer right now, you probably couldn't see anything because there's so much frozen food in there. And it's really great for portions. All right, always find ways to treat yourself. So treating yourself, everyone you hear, like treat yourself, big part of self-care in the kitchen as well. So if you have the budget, I always suggest buying a fancy ingredient or two. For me, sometimes that's buying like an herb or a spice that I've never thought about buying because it's like $5, which like why? But you never know. So sometimes I like to take myself to Fresh Market and like wander the aisles and feel like a fancy like soccer mom and I like look at all the fancy spices and like treat myself to a fancy spice every now and again. But this might look like buying a store, not a store brand ingredient and buying a name brand ingredient instead. Also, I mentioned fancy grocery stores. One of my favorite things ever is to like make the trek to Birmingham to go to Trader Joe's and spend my entire paycheck on probably mostly frozen food, if we're being honest. But take yourself to a fancy grocery store every now and again. That's what keeps cooking exciting, is changing things up, finding little ways that make you want to get into the kitchen and not make it a chore to cook for yourself. Also, splurge on new kitchen gadgets. If you're like me, you love kitchen gadgets. I have a lot, probably too many, that I don't use very often, but it's kind of fun having like
I have like an immersion blender that I don't use that often, but when I do, let me tell you, it's exciting. But I also love my crock pot. So finding little things to make your life easier, if that's a mandolin that helps you chop onions without having to cry all the time like me, then treat yourself to that every once in a while. So, interview. I mentioned lasagna earlier. This is my favorite lasagna recipe. But to review all of the steps, learn to love your grocery store. A plan is good. Simple is better. Always eat what you make. Give your food to others. Not everything has to be from scratch. And always find ways to treat yourselves. So, an easy way to remember this, lasagna. So, if you fell asleep and didn't hear a single thing that I said, that's okay, no judgment, but you should listen now because you need to cook more. Thank you.